So, today we're going to be learning about some tools for interval analysis. And before we go into that, let's just quickly go over what we've done, just to give a recap. We've done FASTQ quality check. We've done the alignment to a reference genome or transcriptome or any ome that you prefer. We've learned a little bit about SAM tools, which is the format. So the SAM is the format of the alignment, and the tools toolkit that you have can be used for multiple things, including conversion to binary formats, as well as it has other tools to call variants, for example, one of them. So now what? So, well, we need information from the read alignments with respect to genomic intervals. So that's an important part. So you have your alignments, but if you're doing, especially if you're doing RNA-seq, what do you do with those alignments is more important. Like, you want to know the counts for certain intervals. So it could be a gene, it could be an exon. Whatever you're interested in, you want the counts. Counts meaning with the pileup of reads, how many of those are covered. As well as we need to manipulate genomic interval files based on read mapping. So this becomes much more useful in the later part of the analysis, where you have these intervals or you have your genes and you're more interested in finding out, okay, what is the nearest promoter, for example, to my gene? Or you have your ChIP-seq peaks file. So these are the a peak is usually an interval, right, from point A in the genome to point B in the genome, usually whatever distance apart. But that file, which says chromosome, position start, position end, strand, that's a BED file, as we had discussed earlier. Now, given multiple BED files, so you have your peaks file in case of ChIP-seq, and then you want to find out what is the nearest promoter, what is the nearest any other binding site. So all of those are done through what we call as genome arithmetic or set tools for the genome. So if you've studied set theory or have a little bit of idea, I'm not talking about the entire set theory, but you're familiar with union and intersection. Those are the two basics, right? So you have set A of elements and you have set B of elements. And if we intersect them, that just means that we're taking whatever is common between them and not in one or the other. And then when we say union, we mean that, you know, basically we want to merge them, those two sets, and want to take account of everything. So basically, those are the two main operations. But these kind of operations you also have for intervals in the genome. You have BED files, you have a start, end, and then you have another BED file with a start, end. Now, what if you want to take the intersection of those intervals, or you want to merge those intervals that are overlapping with each other? So for those kind of analysis, you have a toolkit called BED tools, which is what we'll be going over today. It is very important for us to go through this toolkit because it becomes more and more useful for ChIP-seq analysis, even for RNA-seq or any other kind of, you know, interval intersection that you will be using. Now, I wanted to explain everything as an infographic because a lot of people like these. So this is what we said till so far. This is what we've covered so far. We're here. Now, the alignment can then be passed on to a ChIP-seq analysis toolkit, which we will cover later on, but if you consider that just as a black box, it just helps you find the peaks from your alignments. So where are your binding sites, or where are the histone you've precipitated your whatever protein you're interested in, and so where does it bind to in the genome? That's what you get from this as a BED file, right? And then from here you can go into BED tools, where you manipulate genomic interval files based on read mappings. Also, from the SAM tools, you can go into other parts of analysis. Like, for example, for RNA-seq analysis, there's an intermediate step where we need the counts of each gene, because that's the whole point. Like, how many transcripts were present in your sample for that gene, right? So for that, you have a program called htc-count that helps you, if you give it a reference GTF, which we had covered earlier, which is a genomic reference file with regions of interest, it can give you counts for how many reads line up in that interval. You can also get counts, so this is one option. Another option is also to get counts from BED tools. So BetTools MultiCov is another, it's part of the BetTools suite. There are lots of, just like SAMTools, BetTools has lots of individual programs included within it. So, you know, and so just like SAMTools, where you go SAMTools View, View is a program under SAMTools. And similarly, BetTools Merge is a program under BetTools suite. And we'll be covering those today. Okay? Does that give you a sense of why this is important and what we'll be doing today? All right, everybody on board? Okay. So we'll be covering this and this, and then after that, we'll be going into RNA-seq analysis once we learn R. Because once you get the count table, then it has to be imported into R. So after that step, you have to import it into R. And for ChipSeq, though, you have individual, you know, packages here that can be run on the command line, but ChipSeq analysis can also be done in R. So pretty much from this step, after the counts, or you need to go into R for further downstream analysis. So that's why we'll be taking a break there. Next week we start R and understand and learn programming in R. And then we do, as part of R, we'll be doing RNA-seq analysis. As part of R, we'll be doing ChIP-seq analysis. Yes?
So I have a question. Yeah. I don't know exactly at which step do different ChIP-seq calling programs come into play? Is that
So that's a good question. So it could be right after the alignment.
Okay.
So some ChIP-seq programs take as input the alignment file, BAM file. Actually, all of them take as input the BAM file,
okay.
Except some programs are written in R. So you can call them from R. You can load the BAM file into R. So that's possible. And therefore, this particular analysis can be done in R by getting the BAM file. On the other hand, there are also command line programs that run just on the shell, which will go from here straight to the program, not in R, and it will run your peaks, like Max, which is the biggest program that is used.
Mm-hmm.
It's not run in R, it is run separate from R. And takes in the BAM files and directly calls your peak based on your control and your treatment. It calls your peaks.
So in that situation, you don't have to.
You don't have to call R at all.
Oh.
There are programs in R that also do that, but you don't have to. Max was separate. So I'm thinking of starting R next week just because we have the statistics lecture coming up soon, end of the month. So I wanted you to have a background in R before we go into that statistics lecture. And then later on we'll do Max for after we do R. Ideally, I would have wanted to, if we had covered this lecture last time, today would be the day we'd be covering Max. But that's just one software, right?
Yeah.
So it's just one software on the command line. It's something that we can do after as well.
Yeah.
All right? So is that clear? Does that make sense? Okay, so moving on. What next? I just explained to you, BetTools and HD-seq. This performs the genome arithmetic or set theory on the genome, and HD-seq is a tool that allows users to get counts of reads. So this is very useful for RNA-seq analysis. You need counts for RNA-seq, and this is where you get the counts. Okay? All right. So we went over the why as well. I just thought I'd put it out there as well. In case you want to go through it when you're going through the slides, but this is what we just talked about.
Quick
yes.
question. I feel like when people are discussing RNA-seq, they're always talking about counts or expression, but what are the tools you use to just look at sequence? There's the stuff that we're looking at before.
Sequence for what?
Just like mutations, or you can still do that, right, with RNA-seq?
Is the
coverage not good enough, or?
No, it's good enough. You can use, so the Broad has a toolkit, the GATK toolkit allows you to call variants based on RNA-seq data. It doesn't matter. As long as you align to the genome, you know, you can look for your variants using that toolkit as well.
Okay.
And depending on how much time we have at the end, we'll cover ChIP-seq for sure,
yeah.
And then we'll go over to variants and, you know, the Broad toolkit.
Mm-hmm.
Again, these are also online tools. A lot of it is online. Very little command line is needed.
Mm-hmm.
So if there is a talk that the Cancer Center wants to do a course, a one-day course just on online tools.
Yeah.
So I was thinking I could include that part in as part of that one-day course. So they want to do it for the entire Cancer Center. So you know, so since it's an online tool, it's really just about, it's a lot simpler than doing it on the command line. You just upload the file and press a button and it you give the parameters and it runs everything for you. Okay? All right. So this analysis is done on genomic file formats such as BAM. So BED tools work on BAM files. They also work on BED files. They work on GFF and GTF files. So we are by now familiar with these formats. If there's any question, you can ask me now. Please do so if you're not familiar or you want. Okay, so I assume everybody is familiar with BED format, BAM format, GTF and GFF formats, right? Great, I feel so good. Okay, so basically, as you go along and learn more about this stuff, you will realize that a lot of this analysis, these pipelines, you can customize to your taste, depending on what you want. And BED tools is just another tool that you can use. Honestly, you can also use just shell commands and BED tools together to do very complex analyses. But one thing you want to know is that these are the simple tools that can be built upon. Okay, so that's why they're important. That's why we're covering them today as part of the class. Okay, so we will learn today about three of the important sub-tools within BED tools. The suite, BED tool suite, is a lot longer. It has a lot more tools. These are the most important ones, but I think maybe I'll assign you as homework to go through the other tools using the files that we have. Or just on your own, you can go. BED tools actually has a very great tutorials online. They have tutorial for every single command. So if you just go to the BED tools site, you will be able to find a lot of information about this. All right. But we will be covering these three today, mainly intersect, which is very commonly used, merge, and genome coverage. Okay? Is that clear?
So intersect just looks at the intersection and merge combines the two, right?
The names are pretty standard. Genome coverage gives you the coverage for a particular location base pair, for each base pair, how many reads cover that location. Okay? All right, so we'll be covering these three. They're very exciting stuff. So, and I hope that we will have time towards the end if I keep track. And we will go over HT-seq because that's also very important. If not, we'll go through the practical. All right, so let's start with BED tools. And we'll start with intersect. So my two favorite people intersecting in, I don't know which country this is. I guess France, it looks like this is France or one of those countries. Okay, so a lot of words on this slide, but basically as was suggested earlier, intersect is essentially a way to find out the intersect between ranges. And it takes two BED files, GFF files, or a BAM file and one of the aforementioned files, and identifies all the regions of the genome where the features in two files overlap, okay? Which means that they share at least one base pair in common. Now, this distinction is important. We can specify the intersect. We can specify whether we want one base pair by default. As long as at least one base pair is shared, it'll consider that as an intersect. The overlap between your files. So for example, if you go here, minus A and minus B, so till here, if you can read this command and tell me what it's doing. Anybody want to take a shot at what minus A, minus B are? No? Okay, let's simplify this. Minus A is A file. Anybody want to get what minus B is? It's the B file. So there are two files that we need for intersect, right? You need an A file and a B file. So they labeled it exactly like that. Okay? And then you pipe that to head minus 5, which is doing what? Head minus 5?
Taking the first 5 lines.
Exactly. Out of that. So this intersection would probably have a lot of lines. It's just displaying the top 5. Okay.
But if you don't have the minus A or the minus B flag, does it freak out?
Yeah, probably give you an error.
Okay.
Because it expects two files for intersection. Intersection is always between two things, right? So.
Sorry, head minus 5 meant the first 5
lines.
Three times.
Five lines of the output.
Oh, lines. Okay.
because you're piping this output here.
Would you want to sort that first beforehand?
Good question. I believe that's required for merge. For intersect, it may or may not require. We'll have to check that. I'm certain that for merging, you have to have the file sorted.
Oh, for intersect, it already does the sorting.
I have to check that. I'm not quite sure. But it is always good, as always, it's always good to just sort it. And I do that by default. After my whatever BAM file that I have, I always sort it. And I sort it by default, it sorts by position. So that works. Okay. So intersect options, you have minus WA option. So which basically helps you report the original feature in each file. Write A. WA stands for write A, which means you have the A file and the B file. So if you wanted the output to contain the actual initial file as well as the intersection of that with the other file, you would write minus WA, write A. And as logically it would be, if you wanted to write B, you can say minus WB. Okay. Yes.
I'm getting a little bit confused in terms of contextualizing this. So is the intersect looking at between A and B like tumor and normal for these locations, or are we within one condition looking at?
It could be any two files. Think of it like, how do I say this? So you just want to find out basically if there are if there's a group of intervals like, let's say numbers, right? Do you have a range of numbers? 1 to 5 is in set A, you know? So 1 to 5, 7 to 10, 12 to 15, right? These are three ranges in one set. And then you have another set which has, say, ranges from, say, 2 to 6 and, 7 to 10, right? And now you want to intersect set A and set B. Now, it doesn't have to be that these are set A is a range of all tumor features, and set B is a range of all normal features. It might as well be that set A is just tumor, and set B is also the same tumor sample. But you just want to find out how many of these ranges intersect with each other. So if you wanted to take the intersection, in the first one would be, so there's 1 to 5, and then there was 3 to 7, so the intersection would be 3 to 5.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Can we just talk about like some really basic things? Like
sure.
In set theory, if something's an intersection, it's clear. If it's a 5, it's a 5. In the genome, how do you know if it's an intersection, if it's the same?
So we're talking about the ranges, right? So the locations of the features.
Okay.
So you have a start position in chromosome 1.
Okay.
You have the feature starting at, say, position 200 and ending at a position 300.
Okay.
And the way it's calculated is that normally, so for example, this is most commonly used in ChIP-seq. You have a binding site. You have a protein that binds to a location and you chip it out. Now, based on, of course, it could be off by 1 or 2 base pairs in the actual binding from the biology, but the way the program calculates it is, it'll give it a definitive starting point and a definitive end point. That's what creates the intervals. So chromosome 1, location 200 to 250 is one interval of one feature.
And if they're partly aligned, is that an intersection?
It will be covered by multiple reads, and based on that, you estimate the distribution of where the reads start and where the reads end, and then come up with a point of starting. So that's the whole point of the ChIP-seq Max program, which we'll cover later, is that it estimates based on the read coverage at a particular location whether a peak exists and where the start point of that peak will be based on the reads and where the end point will be based on the reads. Okay? Does that make sense?
Is this similar to like aligning but with smaller portions? Instead of looking at a whole large section, you're saying, okay, I know that this particular sequence, if I look in different ranges here, does it match into those and corresponding to some certain biology?
Were you saying intersect or just the actual ChIP-seq biology?
Or intersect here.
So intersect, it's irrespective of the biology. The biology part is separate from this. Here, I'd like you to focus that once the biology part is over and you have some distribution and something was done by the program and it gave you a feature range. So like for each feature, it says this starts here, this starts there.
Mm-hmm.
So for example, exons or chromosomes, they start in for a gene. They have been defined.
Mm-hmm.
they start exon 1 from on this gene, P53 starts at location whatever, something, chromosome whatever X, to 900 to 950 is the defined exon. Now you want to find out whether that exon overlaps with another some feature, like another protein that you have chipped and you know the location of that feature.
What if it's a partial overlap? What if it's like one inside the other? Like how?
Yeah, all of those are covered so as part of the options. So if we proceed further, you will find out that there's more to it.
When you use the word intersection, what do you mean?
Intersection is as long as there is one base pair overlap.
Okay,
as long as there is one.
That's my question. Okay.
Yeah.
Got it.
Okay. All right.
But you can adjust it.
Okay. Okay.
Yes. Okay. So moving on. So. Counting the overlaps, counting the number of overlapping features, we can also count for each feature in the A file with the number of overlapping features in the B file. This is handled with the minus C option. So you want to not only just have the overlaps, you also want to find how much was the overlap. Okay?
So just the previous slide, when you showed that, and you were, so can you, yeah, so what does that exactly mean?
WA and WB?
No, the stuff that shows up in the bottom. So which is the...
So the first chromosome 1 start end, that is WA, that's the A file.
So that's the A file.
That's the CPG file, right? That's
yeah.
why it's saying CPG 116,
okay.
30. And then the next part, chromosome 1, from here to here, is the B file. And then this is the overlap.
Oh, you see, that's good to know.
Okay? So because you specified WA, now supposing I don't have WB, then these will not be there. Only WA will be written out. Okay?
Right B, and then, okay.
The overlap.
And
then the intersect.
Overlap. And the intersect is which? Is the bottom? No.
It's the end part right here.
Oh,
which is zero in those cases.
Yes. Yes. So in this case, because you want to write A and B, so it'll just say that, you know, for these, there is no intersect.
There's no intersect.
Okay? And then
at least for the first five.
Yes, and when there is intersect, it will tell you how many base pairs or what is the intersect.
And
if you didn't
have the right A, right B, it wouldn't have any like things like that. It would only be the ones where there was an intersect.
Exactly.
Okay.
Exactly. Now, this will become more clear as we go through the practical as well. But yeah, these are good questions, so it's good to clarify them. If there's any doubt, let's clarify that now, and then we can move forward. All good? Yeah? Okay. All right, so, and like we mentioned earlier, if you want to know the count of how much of was the intersect, then you just put minus C, and it gives you, so there's a one base pair, or three, or how much was the intersect, right? Now, sometimes we're interested not just in features that overlap, but features that do not overlap with each other, right? So again, it's just an option. If you put minus V in there, it'll give you the features that don't overlap. Okay? That's just like the complement that you have in set operations. Complement means that it's the opposite of what is there. Okay? Now, as we discussed earlier, sometimes we want to find out whether there's a minimum fraction overlap, at which point we say that, okay, yeah, this makes sense. I don't care about just one base pair overlap. I only want to know if there's a 50% overlap, which you can specify with the minus F option. And then you put there in the end minus F 0.5 as a percentage. So not at 50, not as a percentage, but as a decimal point percentage, so 0.5. And then it gives you only those which have the 50%. Okay?
Sorry, quick question. It looks for intersections based on location or based on sequence?
Location.
Location, okay, that makes a lot of sense.
It's not based on the sequence, because the sequence is no longer present here. Notice the sequence is gone. So now you're not concerned with the actual sequence, you're concerned with the features of that, the positions where that sequence had aligned, or the, because there are multiple reads that have aligned, and you create distributions and you create models to get exactly the start point of the alignment features that you're interested in. So say you were interested, I keep going back to ChIP-seq because that seems to be the most but you can also think of it as, you know, if you're trying to find novel non-coding regions, right? So you see where the reads have aligned. Let's say you have 50 reads aligning in a particular region, and based on whatever model you decide that I will start my, let's say the first position of the first read that is there, I'll put that as a start point. and then the last position of the last read that aligns. So you don't think of it as a normal distribution like that, and you have multiple reads piling up, and you decide that this is the first position, this is the last position for that, based on your model. And then you have the chromosome, start, end, and then you can name that feature. So non-coding feature one, I'll call that. All right? Does that make sense? Linda's still confused.
So you're basically having to rename it? I mean, do the both of the files that you compare, first of all, are they independent of one another?
Yes.
And then they both have the same notation as far as like...
Yes. They may or may not. So you have to have one BED or GFF file. Or you could also have a BAM file. So minus A could be a BAM file. So again, notice that it's more about, you know, like, so if you have a BAM file, say you're interested in how, again, you want to count how many reads align in that feature space. You can do that with BED tools as well. So there's this program called MultiCov or Genome Coverage, which takes a BAM file, and then from the reads, if you specify another GFF file, which contains your start and end for the genome, for exons, then it can count how many reads align to the features in there. Does that make sense? Still a little confusing?
Well, I think the problem is the starting material, I think, is what's a little bit confusing, because if we're comparing a bunch of sequences in, let's say, a BAM file.
Bunch of sequences?
Well, you know, a bunch of reads, you know, from, let's say, a BAM file or something
right.
like that. Then that would be a little bit different than if we're comparing, let's
Two.
Say, a genome or...
Yes. Yes.
You know, so.
Right. So therefore, it's just an additional option that you have.
Yeah.
But if you're just doing intersect,
yeah.
in that case, you won't probably use a BAM file. You'd probably just have a BED file
yeah.
and another BED file, or a BED file and a GTF file, because they form they have the similar format, which is
right.
start position chromosome start end.
Right.
So kind of like this, right? So if you have, you know, this is your A in blue and B sequence in B, and then. Just a simple A intersect B is the top here.
Yeah.
And I mean, it's very self-explanatory, right? So you, A intersects B, you get these two fragments, which are overlapping by at least one base pair. So here, notice here, this fragment does not come in. Now, if you have the minus WA option, then what you get is you get the whole of A written out to you, right? Same here. If you have the minus V option, you get only the part that is not there. Okay?
Well, what is it comparing it? You said it's not comparing sequences or base pairs.
It is comparing the range.
The range. Just
so the start and end. Notice here you have, this is the start point of B, this is the end point of B. This is the start point of A, this is the end point of B, A. So for this, what is the intersect between this and this fragment? Is this one. Similarly, what is the intersect of this fragment with this entire sequence? It's this one. That's what
that
is.
That makes total sense. So when you're thinking about the set, it's actually just numbers like 5, 6, 7, 8.
Right.
They're just
right.
locations.
Right.
And the intersection is just where those sets intersect.
Right.
So where does
okay.
the, you know, you define how many base pairs are matching, so...
You don't have to define how many base pairs are matching because...
You said one or...
You just have like, this is your sequence, right? This is your, this is the feature, whatever it could be. This could be a CPG region, and this could be your exon sequence. And you want to find out like, okay, for these exons, which of them overlap CPG regions? Or this could be your ChIP-seq binding region, and this could be your promoter sites. And you want to find out how many ChIP-seq regions overlap with promoters. Okay?
Oh, overlapping meaning their base pairs match?
Yeah.
I mean, it'll be the same
sequence. Region, just they
right.
share
it. In the genome, the sequence is the same, so that, yeah, that you're right, that's
okay.
basically the overlap.
Okay, I got
but,
confused when you were saying that.
Well, we're not looking at the sequence because the sequence is assumed to be underlying and it's the same, you know. All of these are mapping to the same reference.
Okay.
So there's a underlying reference sequence, which we, right now, we're ignoring, but yeah, that's the whole point, is that when we say they're overlapping, it means that they have the same sequence. In those base pairs. But we're more interested in what portion of that sequence is common between the two. Does that make more sense? Yeah?
So okay. Another question, maybe this is ahead, but when you merge them, is that like a true union? So would you have an overlap of the two? So
you're right,
indicator?
It is ahead. We'll just get
okay.
to it in a second.
Can I ask a question about
yes.
this? Okay. So you mentioned in F that you can then set whatever percentage, like if it's 50% or something. Yeah. So let's say if you're a, you know, a practical example, you have three ChIP-seq results, yeah, three independent experiments, and you're only looking at situations in which you have
one, and you're good.
I mean, you want 50%, but 50% of 10 nucleotides is not something that you're interested in. Do you see what I'm saying?
Okay, so you only want strictly 5 nucleotide overlap.
Let's say you want things that are, well, I guess maybe you have to do it before you get to the F function. Maybe you have to call peaks that are greater than a certain size. You have to give it that range.
Yeah. You can do that when you're calling the peaks in max.
Yeah, okay. So maybe that's what you need
to
do before you
get there. That's the modeling part. That's different for, that comes under ChIP-seq.
That's different.
Yeah. Okay, so merge. Oh, okay. Well,
tell them to finish sequencing my samples. That would be great.
I will. Okay, so let's talk about merge for a second. Now, this is a different kind of merge here. So many data sets of genomic features have many individual features that overlap one another. Example, alignment from a ChIP-seq experiment. Again, I don't know why we keep coming back, but that seems to be the most common use for BET tools. It is often useful to combine the overlapping into a single continuous interval. The BET tools merge command can do this for you. For example, if you have three features like this from three different peak callers or for three different samples, that you know they are saying that, oh, they're overlapping by a certain amount of percentage or certain base pairs, you just merge them. By simple merge, it just gives you the combined merged interval. Similarly here, notice they're 10 base pairs apart, so they're like, I don't think we want to merge them. By default, merge will not merge them. As long as if they're touching or if they have, you know, as long as they're touching each other, they'll be merged right here. But then sometimes you do want to make sure that they are combined into one because they're only 10 base pairs apart or only 50 base pairs apart, which you can do by the minus D option. And you specify the number, minus D 10, which makes that, okay, this becomes one interval all the way from here to here. All right. And then with the minus n option, you're actually able to count how many individual intervals were there initially before the merge happened. All right? Does that make sense? So you had three, that's the number, one, one each. And then you had two, one, two. All right? Okay. So sorting the files is an important step when you're doing merging. Merge will not work unless your files are sorted. So it requires that the input file is sorted by chromosome and position, especially the start position. And here is a simple way to sort your files using the sort command available as part of Unix. So this is not a part of BET tools. What you're doing in this command, let's just focus all the way till here, where you're saying sort minus k 11, minus k 22, and this n exons.bet, which is saying, and then return the output exons.sorted.bit. Okay? Which is just saying that, you know, 11 is this, like, the first column, 22 is the second column. So sort by this, and then by this, and then output it to sorted.bit. Okay? All right.
And k is, where's k minus k?
Minus k is the option for sorted. So if you go man sort, you will see that k is the option to specify the start position and go by that. So which column, which base pair you want to, which column, which location you want to start with, okay, in a file. Click. All right, so then to count the number of overlapping intervals, a more sophisticated approach would be to not only merge overlapping intervals, but also report the number of intervals that were integrated into the new merge interval, which is what we did earlier by minus n or minus c option that we did earlier. All right, so minus n basically gives you how many intervals. Here, this is the number. Okay? Okay. Just going over the same stuff, nothing new. All right. The distance option, we just covered that. I was telling you about the minus d option where you can specify the distance. Right? So we're clear about that? Okay. But then, we often want to know which intervals of the genome are not covered by intervals in a given feature. For example, if you have a set of peaks, you may also want to know which regions of the genome are not bound by the factor as you assay for complement addresses. So, for example, you want to know this part is a complement, in here this is a complement, or this region between these two is a complement, all right? So basically it's the opposite of when you have merged, and then complement of that means that what is remaining, which is not covered. Do you know what I'm saying?
But I thought that was minus b.
Yes, so that you would do by that minus b option.
Okay.
In merge, you can, you know. So, but that, the point is that there is a it is possible to do it, all right? Again, you don't need to remember all of this stuff. I keep mentioning that because in today's age, you know, there's so much information. Our brains are just constantly overloaded with stuff, right? So you can relax your brain and just, there's only one thing you need to remember, and that is if you encounter two files that have intervals, you turn to BetTools, and then you go tutorial BetTools, search on it on Google, and then you'll get to this tutorial, and then you'll come up with this, read through it once, and you'll remember everything. Okay? That's all that you need to remember. All right. Okay, so next we'll talk about coverage. I thought I liked this because...
pileup?
Well, because of the pileup. And the fact that last week I had something similar happen to my car, when it was last Monday. So, but anyways, yeah, somebody went underneath my car and kind of lifted my car. It was fun. Not for the car, but it was the first time I got into such a pileup situation. It was raining, right? Last Monday was also raining.
Yeah,
so the throats were slippery. Anyways, so for such a situation on the genome, right, think of it as they're like, just this is an example, you have multiple reads, they're lining up on top of each other, it's a pileup. Now you want to calculate the coverage for each base or for, you know, an interval. So one of the ways to measure the genome-wide coverage of a feature file. For example, we often want to know the fraction of genome that is covered by one feature, two features, or three features, etc. Right? So this is frequently crucial when assessing the uniformity of coverage from whole genome sequences. This is done with the versatile genome coverage tool. So as an example, this is your, you know, input BAM file example. And then if you do genome coverage here with minus D option, it just gives you the individual coverage for each. Notice this is coverage per base pair. Okay, so the counts that you're seeing are for each base pair location, how many features cover that? So that will become very clear once you see that for this region, there are only one read that covers. So each of these is a read right now because this is a BAM file, right? So this is covered by one read. And for here, from here to here, this interval is covered by two. And similarly here, this interval is covered by three, okay? And so on and so forth. And there are regions that are zero. Now, sometimes you just want the coverage per base pair. You use minus D in that case. Sometimes you want the coverage as a whole for ranges. So for what is, just give me one number for the entire range. I don't want to know each base pair, right? Because that could be very long file because it's every single base pair. You just want to know what are the intervals. So this interval has one coverage. This interval has two coverage. This interval has three, one, nothing. 1, 1, 1, 1, 1. Now, there are multiple options in this case. For example, if you want to have all of the coverage, by default it does not give you this because then there are lots more regions which don't have coverage as opposed to the regions that do. So you'd have a really big file if you just included all the minus BGA option. Okay, so by default it doesn't do that, but in case you're interested in knowing all the intervals, including the ones that don't have coverage, you just go BGA. Yes?
Good question. Why are the regions in the introns where there's like no reads, why is the genome coverage one there? Should be zero.
Because, no. So, yes, good question, first of all. What does it say? Notice that here it says that these are parent or spliced reads. So you have established that these were, in fact, spliced at one point. So that's why you have the option of either reporting them as one. By default, it does that. But if you don't want them to be reported, if you don't want these split reads, which are covering across intervals, then you can do minus D split, and then it comes across as zero. So you're always one step ahead of me. So basically, this is going to come like this. And then the same thing, minus D split gives you the coverage for each base pair, but minus BGA split gives you the coverage across the interval. Okay. So I know there's still some confusion. Let's start with what's you know, what's still not clear? Does anybody want to take a shot at what's not clear, and then I can try and talk about it, if there is anything?
I guess making a GTF or GFF file from your BAM files, is that like after you have your ChIP-seq?
The GTF file is already there. Normally it's for the genome. So,
right.
But the BET file is what you're probably going
right.
for.
Right. I guess how do you get to the...
So that's also there as part of BET tools. You can go BAM to BET.
Okay.
So it converts your BAM file to a BET file.
Okay. So that'll basically take all of your sequences and come up with intervals.
Exactly.
Based on some distribution that you...
Or you could just even say simply that if there is a start point where the first read starts and the last read ends, for that coverage. So, you know, you have reads piling up, you just say start of the first read, end of the last read, that's my interval.
Okay.
By default, it does that. Bam, bam to bed. Linda.
I don't know. I totally get the math, that's fine.
No.
And the programming, but I always have trouble with the underlying biology, like what are we trying to do, because that's the part that I don't know.
Right, so...
Can you give me an example of, like a very specific example of how you would use this? I mean, you keep saying ChIP-seq, but I don't know anything about ChIP-seq.
Okay, so let's start with, okay. So, we're gonna wipe out the board if possible, as fast as possible.
So, like, when would we care about what the intersection is?
Yes.
Is that your question?
Yeah, I get...
Do you know how much ChIP-seq is?
No, she
no,
does
so
not.
I don't know anything.
Right. So, actually...
Can I explain that?
Yeah, please.
One sentence. Like, basically, you're taking a snapshot of the cell, and you're asking this protein that you're interested in, to which parts of the genome does it bind. That's it. And so when you actually sequence, you're sequencing all the DNA that are associated with this protein specifically.
Mm-hmm.
So the information that you get from a ChIP-seq result is not the entire genome, only those places in the genome to which this protein binds.
And so when you say file A and B, A is like
experiment one, experiment two.
And then that's where they overlap.
Well, and then you look for, so experiment one has some variability, experiment two has some variability.
Right.
You don't want to be calling stuff that you're not confident in. You want to look for things that are actually reproduced in both experiments.
Uh-huh. So would they typically be replicates or two different experiments?
Yeah. Wait, it depends on the experimenter.
Uh-huh.
I think two different experiments is the best way to go. But some people use technical replicates versus biological replicates.
Okay.
So let's say this is our experiment one where you have, you know, this is our genome. This is a reference genome sequence.
Mm-hmm.
Think of it as a line of base pairs, you know, going from A, T, G, G, C, blah, 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 all the way to the end. All right? Starting from chromosome 1 to chromosome 2 to chromosome, 23, like that, all the way. 20, X and Y, all that. So you have experiment 1. Experiment 1 consists of reads that align like this. Right. Now, experiment 2 also consists of reads that align somewhere now. This is what we covered with the alignment, right? So we align this to the genome. Now, it does not matter what the biology behind this is. It could be ChIP-seq, it could be RNA-seq. We don't care at this point, right? What we do care is okay, now I have these reads. Can I make regions out of these reads where these, you know, like, can I collapse them and find a start position for all of this and the end position? So let's say we start here. Our simple algorithm is if there is one read that covers a position, that's fine. So here, this is our start point right here. And then the end point, let's assume there's coverage here, all the way till here. This is the last end point from the read. So all of these reads will be grouped into one interval, which says this is a start point A, and this is a start point B, and this entire becomes a feature.
And just to give a biological context, like, if you were saying this could be a region of the genome that a protein is bound to.
Yes.
Okay.
It could be a region where the protein comes in, and this is a protein, whatever, protein comes in and binds in this exact region.
Transcription factor binds, for example.
A transcription factor. And then we can actually go and create methods to, you know, chip out or extract these transcription factors And then we sequence that particular region, and in the end, we're left with this. We're basically looking at here, T to C is our sequence of the transcription factor binding site, which we just chipped out. Now, similarly, we have another one here to here. That is our feature 2 that goes from here to here. And so this is feature 1, this is feature 2. So here we have feature 3. Here we have feature 4, like that. Now this is just for experiment 1. So we do the same exact thing for experiment 2. We come up with features like this. So experiment 2, this is feature 2, starts here and goes till, let's say, here. All right, and then, sorry, feature 1 for experiment 1, experiment 2. And then this is feature 2 for experiment 2, start and end, right? So basically, we're collapsing the reads, coming up with features. Now, what a feature means is there's a start, there's an end, position, right? Because, and that position is with respect to this genome, okay? And then also, the other thing that you need is, of course, the genomic scale, the way we measure it is that it starts, it's based on three things. It's a chromosome, and then the location on that chromosome, right? So this is chromosome 1, this is chromosome 2, and then in chromosome 2, this is start 1, start end, sorry, start 2, end 2, for feature 2. Write that. So now we have the features between the different experiments. Now let's say we want to find out whether can we merge these experiments and come up with a unified set of peaks. So if we're merging these three, it looks like, let's assume they overlap here and here. So we'd merge them, start the start position of this to the end position of this. This will be your new feature that you create after merging these existing features.
It seems like it's very dependent on where that start is.
Yes.
Where you start your counting,
yes,
to get everything aligned.
Yes, absolutely.
So, how reliable is that? Do people often like kind of let things offset a little bit to see if...
So that depends on what model you use to create.
Mm-hmm.
And that all comes under, there's a whole, like I said, the Max suite. It was written a while ago for ChipSeq and Peak. And other statisticians have come up with modeling methods to be like, well, they can keep arguing, well, no, it's not good that this is the start point. I think this should be the start point because it is covered by two reads.
Yeah.
So there is more confidence here.
Right.
So based on the confidence and the probability and all that stuff, you can use that model and come up with this. And you can vary the parameters to come up with your own specific model. And basically, you'll get the start and end. But this, what we're talking about, is after that. So after that, what we're interested in, okay, so between these two experiments, what if we want to merge these features? What if we want to find the intersection? What if we want to find the regions that are not covered?
So in all these algorithms, it's always looking at the quality and the strength, right, of the,
yes,
that score. So it's always kind of enfolding that into its calculation.
Yes.
Hidden part of the code.
Yes.
Yeah, maybe using that example, the ChipSeq is becoming a little bit clearer to me.
Uh-huh.
But let's say you're tumor normal, somatic alterations, DNA, and then differential expression RNA. Is,
yes,
this bed tools and this intersection merge commonly used for that purpose? I'm having a little bit harder time translating to those purposes, but the ChipSeq I'm getting.
So for RNA-seq, most likely what you get is, you know, you get the gene expression. RNA-seq is a little different, right? You're looking at the expression for transcripts that you've gotten already.
Right.
So you see you have tumor samples and you have normal samples,
yeah,
right? Most common comparison is what are the differences between these two samples.
Yeah.
But that part is not got nothing to do with bed tools.
Okay, so you
so
wouldn't need that for that.
You,
okay,
wouldn't need that for that.
And then this part, this genome coverage part, like let's say you want to look at genome,
yes,
coverage tumor normal, is that the context for using,
yeah,
this?
Yeah, so you could basically, if you want a genome coverage, is important because you could use that technically to get your, you know, say you have multiple samples and you want to just get the coverage for three samples because they're replicates. And so you can combine those three samples using genome coverage and be like, okay, give me the intervals for each of this, like something like this, minus BGA.
If you sequence the same person three times, that would be one way, but if you had, like, to say, three different people,
then why would you, unless there's a reason
that, right,
why you want to combine them, you wouldn't.
Okay, all
right. Right? Okay. So, moving on.
So that's a quick related question, sorry. So just in that example we had on the board, who decides whether all those little like reads together are fragmented just because of the sequencing nature of the Lumina sequence and they're part of one feature versus like it's actually like two features versus one feature? Do you know what I mean? Who decides that? I can point it out.
Your algorithm, the computer person who wrote that program and the model that you select. So there, hopefully there are enough options for the user to select that model. So that's what you study as part of the Max program if you go into details. I mean, they've done a lot of work beforehand to come up with that algorithm. So they have done all the work that they thought was responsible. It was published in peer-reviewed journals to make sure that other people agree that this is a good way to come up with, which is why you have papers in Nature Methods, or you have, you know, bioinformatics journals, which basically does exactly that. So like, can we all agree that this is a good model to decide that the feature starts here and not two bases?
That's my question, exactly.
Okay. Not two bases down
out.
The line.
Okay. Cool.
Right? But we could go into that, but then that becomes an advanced course.
Okay. Yeah.
All right. Okay. So you guys, I understand your curiosity, and this is great, but you know, like basically all of this stuff, we could do an advanced course and we can then go into details about the modeling and how that works. But for now, basically what you need to understand is that it is possible to, and if somebody has done it for you, and all you need to know is that this is how we do it.
Can I just say one thing regarding those questions? Very important, because depending on which program you use, you can get completely different.
Exactly, because the underlying algorithm.
So for example, Max is great for calling transcription factors. We were using it to call histone modifications. Not good. We didn't know that. We figured that out. So now we're using a different program, and it's
which one are you
so
using?
SPP, and it's way better.
So is there like a database where people have like come up and said, okay, this is...
Not really. So that's, I had to go to some experts to get that information and looked at our data and said, don't use Max too. And here are the keys. And like, nah, it's, the overlap wasn't great and all this other stuff. And then now that we're using SPP, you know, between replicates or, you know, our reproducibility of peaks is over greater than 80%. And I mean, that's fantastic. Before we were getting 50%, which was lousy. So again, depending on which program you use, you can get completely different results. So it's very important. The algorithm is extremely important, and many of the algorithms are designed for a very specific kind of chip. And remember, at the end of the day, the thing that really makes and breaks your experiment is the quality of the experiment.
Right.
Yeah, so maybe can you discuss very quickly? No.
No, that's
a beyond. I have a quick question. So in terms of when you're saying reproducibility, this was reproducibility in a technical replicate or a biological?
No, biological. I don't do technical.
So guys, we have to really finish HT-seq, and we'll keep the conversation for the practical, which will be over in just about 10 minutes, all right? No, it's great that everybody's, you know, asking all these great questions. I'd love to answer all of them and go into details of the algorithms. Like, but the basic thing, what you pointed out, is like just like top hat, bow tie, star, they're all different algorithms in the back end.
Mm-hmm.
And what you use defines how your alignment comes out.
Right.
Similarly, your downstream analysis depends on the package. Same thing in R. If you use edge R versus DSeq versus cufflinks. So all of those things, the only way to learn is to trial and error. You go try it out, and then you go to the online forum. You get, you know, someone's review. You go read papers. You go read journals. And then you find out that this is a great way to do it, because each of these has a very specific case, which is beyond the scope of this course. We could literally do an entire course just on which one is worth which, and then go into details on that. All right? But the basis of what we're trying to learn here is that A, that there are these multiple options, and B, if you were to find these multiple options, how would you go about trying to even start to do your analysis and go from end to end using not option A, but option B? All right, that's what you're learning in this course. Okay, all right. So bed graph output, again, the minus BG option produces a bed graph output, which is essentially the same thing in the range, but it combines them to create one bed file, right? So the output is a bed file as opposed to a single base pair coverage that we had in the previous slide. Okay, is that clear? So instead of getting 1, 2, 2 like this, you get like a range. That's it. Okay, so finally, counts for reads. This is the part where we do HT-seq and counting reads. A few tools are available for counting. Just like we said earlier, there are multiple tools. There are multiple ways. Depending on the algorithm you use, you'll get a different count. So again, very important to choose which algorithm you use. And I can tell you for the purpose of my counting for RNA-seq, I use HT-seq, which is why I'm covering this. and I also use bed tools. I do not use cufflinks and top hat, but that is just my choice for RNA-seq. They are good tools, nevertheless. They are very useful for other things, and they make your life simple to a good degree. We'll go over your question in a second. Let me just completely finish this. So, HTC count, it's a simple Python base. You can download it from this link, or it is already available on the IRIS1 cluster, so you don't need to download it. If you want to install it on your machine, that's also possible. You just follow the instructions over there. It can be used for quantifying genes and transcripts based on the ID in the GTF. So based on this gene ID or the transcript ID, you can get your counts based on this gene ID and the region that it is. So for in a GTF file, a gene ID basically tells you, notice that this gene ID is common across till it changes here, and the gene ends, and a new gene starts. Okay? So basically it tells you for one gene ID, there's a stop codon, there's a start codon, and all of those stuff. So per gene ID, you can get the counts. That means per gene, you can get the counts. You can also have multiple transcripts. Again, the biology is different. We'll go into that later. But you take it, suffice to say that there are they could be different transcript IDs and the same gene ID and stuff like that. And so depending on if you want the counts based on those, you just specify that I want the counts for transcript ID, not the gene ID, and you'll get the counts for that. All right. The format, the counting modes. So just like bed tools, there are multiple modes that you can use to count, which basically, in a similar fashion, are designed to see whether the read overlaps a gene completely, semi-overlap, spanning the gene across two exons, or split reads like this. There are different modes for that. And based on the three modes, union, intersection strict, or intersection non-empty, you will get different counts. And it tells you where it's no feature versus where it is considered a feature for that gene. Okay? So for example, union, in this case, since it's a clear overlap, union, intersection, intersection, all of them will count this read as belonging to gene A. In this case, where intersection strict means I want the read to be completely within the boundaries of the gene, therefore here, it will not count this read, but here and here, it considered it as part of the gene count, all right? So similarly, you can go through these and decide which one is better. I use intersection strict, okay? But that said, sometimes you can also, but that's just because I want to be very stringent in my counts. I'd rather underestimate and reduce my false positives this way. Okay, but you can use whatever works for you based on what you want. Now, this is just a bunch of commands. We'll go over these in the practical. But this is an example of how you can use bsub with HTC count to submit a job with different options. So minus m is the mode, intersection strict, which we just talked about in the last slide, minus s stranded. So it's not stranded, meaning that the data, the reads that we get from the sample are not stranded, followed by the name of your SAM file or BAM file, depending on what you can input both. This says right here with the defaults. The default is union, so if you don't specify anything in the mode, it'll automatically take union, okay? So this is an example of what comes out. It gives you your gene name based on the GTF and the count of how many reads were there. For one sample, two columns, gene, counts. That's it, okay? That's your HTC count. You can then, this is a simple command of basically how you can do it in Excel. Take your files, copy each column, because you want to build a table, right? You want to have a table of your gene names and your counts for each sample. Sample one, what are the counts? Sample two, what are the counts? So if you run this multiple times, you can write it in your LSF file as, you know, for each sample, just the same statement with different sample name, okay? And you do that, and then in the end, you have your count.out file for each, and you can combine them using this paste command given right here. Again, not going to go into the details, but you eventually this command gives you the output like this. It's a simple shell command. We'll go over it in the practical, just for the interest of time.
So that's just giving you the RPMs?
Exactly. Well, not the RPMs, the actual read counts. RPM would be reads per million, which you can then calculate in R on your own. So you sum them up. RPM is simply just total sum as a percentage of the million. If there were million counts, how many of those counts would be there? Reads per million.
So all of that and the
is done in R.
Is done in R.
But before that, you have to get the counts till you get here. And the one last thing, I want to introduce cufflinks as well here, because a lot of people do use cufflinks as an alternative. So here, it's very useful if you want to use cuff diff. So just like, you know, if you want to keep doing everything on the command line, that's the way to go. You use cufflinks followed by cuff diff, and then you don't have to use R. So you don't have to go into R. You can just straight away do your differential expression on the command line. But if you want to be more,
need a reference file to create any sort of feature
counts. And then, of course, you need the SAM file or the BAM file, because that's your where your reads are. Okay, so two things, the feature file, which is a GTF, and then the SAM file. And then you just enter those, and it gives you, for example, and then it gives you the count. Notice that this also requires your file to be sorted, your SAM file to be sorted. Notice here, minus K is 3-3, not 1-1, because the start position starts in column 3 in the SAM file, as opposed to column 1 in a bed file. That's the reason why you have different counts, 3-3 and 4-4, instead of 1-1 and 2-2 in a bed file. Okay? And the other format is exactly the same. It gives you your sorted file based on that. All right. So these are the output files that it creates from cufflinks, which is one is a transcriptome assembly. So using the transcripts, it creates its own assembly file. So we were talking earlier about alignment and assembly as two different things. Supposing you don't have a novel known genome, you have a novel genome and you want to find out what is a GTF for that, you don't have a reference. So cufflinks actually helps you create a reference file for you if you don't have a GTF for a genome. For most genomes, we have that GTF, so we don't normally need this GTF. It just creates it for you. And then this, it also calculates the isoform expression file. So some of you may be familiar with isoforms. Those who are not, we can go into that detail later. But suffice it to say that there are, it's just another, how would you say, Moses, another variation of a gene?
They're basically different splicing,
variants
of the
same
gene.
Of the same gene, they could be multiple isoforms, and then it calculates the call the counts for each isoform and what isoforms are there, and it gives you the counts. So these are the three outputs that it creates. The third one is the expression counts. That's the one you need, and all of these files are straight away transferred into from cufflinks. You can go straight to cuffdiff on the command line using the same output files. So it makes it easier to do differential expression there. Now, with bed tools, there's also an option for counting, and this is sometimes very useful. I just wanted to put it out there. And this multi-cuff command can be used with options. Again, you give it multiple BAM files, and it creates your counts straight away from multiple BAM files. So that's the advantage, is you don't have to do it one BAM file at a time. You can give it multiple BAM files and a reference bed file, and it will create your count table for you. You see?
So counts
for each of the BAM
files. Each of the samples that you have.
And,
samples
yes, so you give it a bed file or a GTF or a GFF file.
Yeah, well,
and it just creates the count table for you. Right? So it makes it slightly simpler. It removes that step of assembling the counts from each BAM file. Mm-hmm. All right? But that said, the counts will be different between this and HT-seq, although not too much, but it'll be slightly different. Okay? All right. So with that, we end this lecture, and now you can ask questions.
Does this normalize for like the size of the gene? Because wouldn't you, like, if you have a million...
So normalization is the second part, which we do in R. Now,
do you have that in? Because all you have
in cufflinks, it is done, huh?
Like, you just have read count in it.
Yes.
It's just like one number.
Yes, it's exactly that. That's what we want. As a bioinformatician, I don't want to know FPKM, RPKM to start with. I can calculate that on my own.
Oh, you just go grab whatever the... total sizes, then you okay.
You could do it that way. Right. Cufflinks, on the other hand, gives you RPKM, or FPKM as they call it. And that's your normalized read count based on the transcript size, which they calculate from the GTF. So, but that said, it's like a one-way street. Once you have RPKM, it's very hard to go back and calculate the read's actual counts. And certain programs in R, for example, DE-seq or EDGE-R, which are now most bioinformaticians are using for differential expression, they don't take RPKM counts as the initial counts. The logic for that is that, again, we'll be covering this in RNA-seq again, but the simple logic is that, you know, if you're comparing across samples and not across genes, then the size of the gene does not matter.
Mm-hmm. Okay, cool.
So in that example, you had a number like 67 that went to one gene. Is that that gene has been covered in 67 different reads? Is that right?
That means that the number of reads that align within the start and end position of that gene are 67.
Okay. So you can assume that each base pair is covered at least 67 times?
No.
No?
No.
No, you can't. Yeah, that's right. No, you can't. You, it could be any number.
It
maximum
could be just,
is 67, but it could
that's be. The total number of reads that were aligned in
right.
that start and end. It could be across exons.
Yeah, yeah.
It could be that they could be all 67 on one exon.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. I got it, yeah.
Okay, 5-minute break, and then we start the practical. All right?
That was a long one.
This Thursday does not work for the practical for me. So we're gonna try and cover a lot of this today. And then if you have doubts, we'll have to do this week, we'll just have to do with you contacting me via email or scheduling a time. Thursday is a bit booked for me for certain other tasks. But that said, we'll go through a lot of this today and the rest of it should be self-explanatory in the practical file. Copy the bedtools.tutorial.sh file, which is located in bioinformatics class folder, and copy it to your own directory.
And you put it in the tutorials folder?
Well, you don't need to put it in the tutorial. You can copy it to your directory, and then there is another bedtools tutorial folder here that we will be working off of, but bedtools-demo. Now, open that file in actually ignore what it says in the beginning of that and see if you can do this.
No, that tool is first of all.
So I just have it in my just folder.
So don't do anything once you have opened that file. Don't do anything yet. See if you can do this once you are in your folder. So let's say I am in my folder. This is the command that I want to do. So here. Make sure you're in your folder when you type this command. PWD, my folder name, all right? This is your folder. This is the command that you typed then. ln minus s, which is saying create a hyperlink to this folder.
Oh, that's why I did it, okay.
Bioinformatics class / bedtoolsdemo dot, and then press, make sure you're in your folder when you do this. All right, press enter. Okay?
So what did we just do then, sorry?
We just created a hyperlink to this directory, and now if I do an ls in Vishal.
Did I have to put dot at the end there?
No, you do not have to put any, don't put anything, no dot, nothing, just see. This is just all you have to do, ln minus s, space, and there is no dot, nothing, just create a hyperlink to this directory in your directory. Okay? What it does then is it creates a link to that directory as if it is on your directory. So rather than everybody copying this and creating multiple copies of this file, of this directory, I just had you create a hyperlink. All of you are now linked to that one directory. So the files are common. And you'll all be working off of those same files. So one important thing is to not delete anything in the directory. So next thing you can do is, if you do an ls, it'll show you this directory, but it's in a different color. Okay? All right, so you just created a hyperlink. Okay, so if you really wanted to see where it points to, you can do ls minus al, and it shows you exactly where that points to. So in this case here, bedtools demo points to mghcc bioinformatics class bedtools demo. Is everybody there? Yeah?
No.
Okay. Now, I'm assuming that everybody has copied the file? If not, do this. cp/data/mgscc/bioinformatics/class/bedtools. Tutorial dot sh, and here you press a dot after the space. Okay, this is your copy command for copying the shell file and opening it in TextWrangler. If you have not done it, do it now. Press enter. This will create a copy of the file bedtools tutorial dot sh in your local directory.
Yep, that's it. In your
I did the CP, but I didn't put the dot at the end.
That's fine. If you don't put the dot, it'll still copy it.
Okay. Because it's in my.
Yeah, so you will have this. I usually do it just because for sake of convenience.
Oh, okay.
Now you open this file by going to TextWrangler. You open this file. File, open from SFTP server. You connect. Connect. You go to this folder. Sorry, you go here, go to. And then in here, you go into your directory and open your bedtools.sh, tutorial.sh.
Yeah. All
right? Okay. Now, read through this. Don't do these steps because you've already created a link. These are there just so that in case you want to do it on your own personal computer, these are the steps that you will follow if you want to replicate this exact tutorial on your machine after you install BedTools on your MacBook, because it's possible to do that. You can install BedTools on your machine, and then these are just the bed files and the sample files that are available from this. So curl-o is a command that we use to download from the web. So it's basically saying send a request, download this from the HTTP protocol using HTTP, download this tar file, this bed file. All of these are example files that we need to run our tutorial. In our case, these already exist on your bedtools tutorial directory. So if you do ls bedtools demo, you will have these files already existing. You will also have the unzipped already version, the untarred version of this. So till here, you don't need to do anything. We'll start from here after doing the ls minus l or ls minus like this. So you go to cd bedtools. Now you can go into your directory and just do ls minus l or ls minus 1, whatever you want. And then you'll see your files here. Okay, does everybody see this? You should see this. In your bedtools directory. You do a cd into your bedtools directory.
Bedtools demo.
Bedtools demo.
Yeah. Yes, that's the one.
But that'll be, then we'll all be in the same directory.
Yes, you are all in the same directory at this point.
So go into bedtools demo.
Yes, okay. Now, so the rest of the stuff, we'll just go through it and try to start doing stuff, and then I'll go individually. Basically, your directory contains 23 bed files and one genome file. 20 of these files starting with F are for fetal tissue, because this is from this experiment, this paper, Morano et al., symbolic localization of common disease associated variation in regulatory DNA. And basically we're using their data set. So here we download their data set and then we unzip it, and we have our F for fetal tissue, and then the remaining you have cpg.bed represent the CpG islands in the human genome. exons.bed represents the ref exons for the human genes. These are all from a human data set. GWAS.bed represents the human disease associated SNPs that were identified in the GWAS studies. Okay? So this is a description of the files. And the latter three files are extracted from the UCSC Genome Browser stable browser, which we covered briefly in the class earlier. You can go to the table browser and again download these files. You don't need to, they've been provided for you, so you can use them here. Right? It's just saying that where they came from, so in case you want to replicate them, you can go ahead and do that. Right? The next step, bedtools. Now, as always, if we type bedtools, it's not going to work. The reason is because.
No,
you're. So do module load bed and then press a tab and see what you get. If you don't get anything, that's sad. Okay, everybody get this? Okay, so make sure in future when you run this tutorial on ERIS-1, I didn't type it because you could also be running this locally. So I'm just going to put a comment here. You can add this as well. If running on ERIS-1, run module load bet tools 2.17. Okay, I've commented this so that you know that if you're running on ERIS-1, you run this. Otherwise, if you have bet tools installed locally on your machine, you don't need to run this. Bet tools should work as is. Okay, for now, you do module load bet tools, and then it should just go. So here, this is right here.
Okay.
Right here. Next step, you type bet tools and see what you get. Right? So for everything else, just keep start following the tutorial. You don't need me to, I'll go at my pace, but you can start going ahead if you are ahead. That's fine. If you run into errors, call me out. I'll keep talking, and those who want to follow me, feel free. If you want to go ahead, go for it.
This won't make files that we're all doing redundantly in that folder.
No, it's just gonna.
We're not making a file.
I mean, we can try and see. Most likely, you're not all gonna run BetTool Intersect on this at the same time. If you do, I don't think. Okay, let's do an experiment. Everybody, once you've loaded BetTools, copy and paste this command. Don't press Enter. All right, copy and paste this command at the same time. We'll press Enter. Hold on.
Hold on, wait for us.
If you loaded module load BetTools, copy and paste this command onto your terminal and do not press Enter. I will say 1, 2, 3, Enter, and then we press Enter.
We're pressing it on Enter, not on 3. Right?
No, we press Enter on Enter, not on 3.
Not on 3, are you sure? Yeah.
Yes. Okay. 1, 2, 3, Enter.
Open, exit,
and
time.
They work.
Mine worked.
Yeah.
Okay, so it worked for everybody. Okay, so we're fine. We didn't crash the computer. Nothing happened. The world is still okay.
ERIS-1's on fire.
ERIS-1's not on fire. All right. So, anyways, so that means that we can in fact go through. What happened?
It didn't open. It said exiting! Exclamation mark. Could not be opened.
Really?
Yeah.
Huh. Try again. If it opens again,
I module loaded the bed tools 2.17.
So maybe or someone else in the room pressed at the same time. So it does produce a small lock for a brief period of time. So what happens is that the operating system can put a lock on a file if it is being used, and then it will not allow another user to access the same file. So,
but
anyways,
she can't do it again. She still can't do it.
Okay, so then that's something else.
Well, if we do it again, what would happen right now if I were to do the same command again?
Nothing. You will run the same command again. The same thing will happen.
But why is it working?
I'm impressed at how fast it is.
Yeah, it is really fast. Okay, so the rest of you proceed further. Read through this. Please read the comments. They are there for you. Read each comment, and then I will try to help.
It's also called algorithm, so it's just written very efficiently.
Oh, you loaded module load before that. Exit out and load back in.
What do you mean?
So the module load bet tools, now you have two versions of bet tools.
But no, it was just display all this, and I said no.
But you pressed enter after module load bet tools.
But you did it again.
Really bad? Okay.
Yeah.
So I do what now?
Exit and log back in.
The whole system.
Yeah, that's the easiest thing to do. You have to type every time?
Yeah.
Okay. So, does everybody get this? You're able to notice if you press module load bet tools, the problem that she's having was she just wrote module load bet tools lowercase and pressed enter. So apparently there's another version of BetTools that is available, but that might be an earlier version which is leading to not the right the right answers. So you have to load this specific version, 2.1.7 with BED capital that we did. Okay, so let's move on. So we just saw an example of intersect. By default, these are the stuff that we were just talking about. Let's identify all of the CPG islands that overlap exons. And these are your CPG islands that are overlapping exons. Next, this was the WA, WB part that we covered. So let's go ahead and run this and see what happens if we copy paste this. And so here, this is one way we see that we have A and B. Now, in order to verify that it actually does load A and B, we could just do this and type it to head minus 5, where all I'm doing is I'm just basically getting the 5 lines from, or you could do cat cpg.bed and get the first 5 lines. So notice the first 5 lines of cpg.bed are in fact the ones that are here, which is cpg 116, 130, and this is how they look like. And those are exactly the things that are output for minus WA option. Another thing you can do is to play around is to not have WB and see what happens. If you don't have WB, then the output is different. It just gives you the WA and it does not give you the other options, okay? As opposed to when you have both. All right?
So, we would have had to already ran like a SAM or a BAM file through bed tools to make these bed files, right?
Well, CPG and exons are common. Like these are just downloaded from the UCSC genome browser because these are normal CPG islands for the human genome, exons for the human genome. These bed files can be downloaded from the UCSC genome browser.
Okay, but just think like if we were making our own pipeline, like to get to just a naive question, to get to a bed file, I went from like my FASTQ and then I went to SAM or BAM and then I went to bed.
Yes, okay. You can create a bed file from your BAM file.
Okay.
So let me Google that for you. Create SAM, bed from BAM. So there is BAM to bed under bed tools, and that does exactly what you asked for. So this bed tools tutorial is very useful. BAM, bed tools, BAM to bed options minus I BAM. By default, the output is bed, okay? And then the options are here, bed type, mate pairs, split reads or not, and then all these other things that, if you want to add the cigar string, the one that we covered in SAM tools, remember that big cigar string which had all these characters?
Oh.
That character is the NHI 10, NHI, all those characters that are there to specify where the alignment occurred, where the, whether it aligned properly, how many mismatches were there in the read. That's part of your SAM file, right? So that can also be made part of your BAM file, so if you put the minus cigar option. But anyways, most likely won't need it. So this is the output that you get, like this, chromosome 7, start, end, and your ID. Okay? That's the BAM to bed. All right, moving on. Yeah. Yeah?
I was laughing about Tupac.
That's interesting.
Yeah, well, you can name anything, right? So people get creative. This is another, minus V options. Often we want features in a file that do not overlap, so minus V is your friend in that case. Feel free to work through that and see what happens. Oops. What happened here?
Yeah, I got the same
one. Yes.
Okay, we all got the same error.
The minus V you want, right?
Oh. Well, it's because,
you didn't put the pipe in.
Yes, exactly. So, thank you. I did that intentionally.
Yes.
I was trying to see who would come up with the answer. Looks like only Linda was paying attention. So, it calculates everything and gives you the ones that don't overlap with the minus V option. All right, feel free to go through this. And then the next one is intersect with only 50% reads that are there. And then you can get that. All right, so most of this bed tools tutorial is pretty self-explanatory. You can do the sorts and everything. I would suggest that you do it as part of your homework assignment at home, because this really is just about following these commands and they're very much gonna work. The part that I'm a little bit more concerned about is, this one right here. Okay, so now one part of this is basically using the SAM tools to create a for a BAM file to indexes, which we did earlier. But since we were using a different genome, we used a Flybase or some other E. coli genome, so those won't work with this, right? Because that's different genome, humans, flies. So what we'll do here is there is another folder. Give me a second here. It's called... Oh, wait. HTSeq Practical. And in here, you have three files. One of them is the testht38.sorted.sam. And then there's a GTF file here.
Should we copy that or just link to it?
I'd just suggest link to it. So I think this is just an example of how to run HTSeq. So it gives you the test.table as the output from this. But that said, what I think we can also do is, so here's what we do. Okay. Just like we did with BetTools, we're going to go into our directory. Okay. Let's go to CD Vishal, or not or your name. And then we're going to do the link command again, where we go ln-s /data mgcc_bioinformatics class /htseq practical. And then we press enter. Okay, and then if you do an ls, you should see HTSeq Practical also linked to your directory, just like BetTools was. Now, I assume that you're gonna have a generic accepted hits.bam.
Wait. Can you go back to your terminal?
Was ln-s?
Yes. ln minus s.
Oh, ln.
Link minus s is a command that links your output, no, your directory. Okay, now, has everybody done that? Can I move on? Okay.
I'm having trouble.
Okay,
for
sure. If you are in your directory,
I did that the first time too.
Yeah, I think
you got it.
Did that twice.
Okay, everybody with me? Okay, good. So now let's go back to our tutorial. Now here I had assumed that you'd be having a BAM file, so this is more generic. All right. So normally Top Hat gives you an accepted hits.bam, right? That's your output from Top Hat, right? So the code here is more for the generic version in case you get an accepted hits file or a BAM file from a program. Then how do you go from there to, converting and getting stuff to BetTools, and there's a BAM to BET example here. Now, in our case, if you use this file, which is also a possibility, the simplest way to do it would be to go to HTSeq Practical and module load SAM tools.
There are many different versions.
Right. So which one was the one that we wanted? -0.1.18. Is that the one that everybody gets? Does everybody get that one?
I don't know how to get it. How do you make your list of SAM tools?
Just
are...
tap?
Yeah, it doesn't work for me. Yeah, mine doesn't either.
Here we go. Yeah, no, I got two.
It takes a couple of seconds.
Yeah, I do have 0.1.9.
Okay, everybody has that 1.18, then just type that and press enter.
What if we already loaded another one? How do I unload something?
That's what I know. There should be a way. I don't really know.
You have to go all the way out and come back in.
What happens with version.
Okay, so let's do man module and figure this out.
Yeah.
Is there a way to unload?
Did you?
That's okay. I'll just go with 1.1. I'm sure it's fine.
Well, I'm sure there's a way to unload.
Oh.
Unmount.
So did you put cdhtc?
Yeah.
And you couldn't get into it?
Here,
module unload. Unload module file.
Oh, it's just module unload?
Yeah, module unload.
Awesome.
So you don't have to log out. Next time, just go module unload. Right? Okay, so you module load your SAM tools, and then you can convert this SAM to BAM. How would you do that? Anybody remember? SAM to BAM. Anybody remember how to convert from SAM to BAM?
You just Google it, didn't you?
That was BAM to bed.
BAM to bed.
Same day, right?
Probably won't work.
SAM to BAM. SAM tools dash B.
It's okay. SAM tools view minus B SAM file. But this file is probably not a BAM file, so but it's truncated because I probably truncated it earlier. Alright. Another option is I could just give you one of my BAM files. So give me a second here. I'll copy a BAM file into this folder. And then you can just use that for the analysis. I'll copy an accepted hits.bam into this folder. All right. In the meantime, please go ahead and start, completing your BedTools tutorial from where you were. Okay.
So doing LS, where are you right now? Why is that show up in this?
Hippasham.
Yes.
The link I created is not like the nice blue. It's like a black and red.
That's because
data.
Yeah, I did that too. The link is somehow the command was wrong. Like the original
the
link was wrong.
The path wasn't right. So
go back to the original.
So just go either unlink or rm.
I just removed the file.
Rm and then that.
That link name.
Do I have to do the cursive or anything?
No, just don't do /data/that. Just do rm that link name.
That won't delete the file from wherever it is.
It'll just delete the link.
Yeah.
I'm in the same directory as the
best files,
right?
Okay, now.
I'm in the
dash s.
You're like in this whole
/space.
HTC.
And then /data.
So if you just want to
underscore, and then tab it in this thing. And then HTC.
Oh yeah, then you see
No, HTC. And then tab it here. Okay, and then press actually HTC practical. I don't have a slash at the end.
Oh really?
No, it should be LN.
LN faster.
They had LN before.
LN. Now, at the end, I don't have that /. But I'm not sure if that makes a difference. So now, it should work now. LS, that's it.
Okay, so I don't know what I did. Thank you.
Yeah, I guess I just had the wrong.
Some change directory.
So
yeah, you're doing your practical from where we left off BedTools while I arrange for a BAM file for you guys to work on. Okay.
Yeah, so this is a region that is not covered by any of the regions that are covered in the key folders.
I see. And then for example, then for this one,
it's
these all overlap.
So it's intersect. Yeah, these are the intersects between file A and file B. This listed here, chromosome 1.
So visually, things are like stacking up on top of each other.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay. And then what does this number mean?
CPG 16. I think that is, so this is your file A, this is your file B. So CPG 116 and chromosome 1. So this is the region of your file A.
Oh, wait, is it being highlighted?
I think chromosome 1 is that's file A.
Is there not exons.bed in there either?
I think. And then CPG 116 is file B.
Sorry?
Oh.
I think I was trying to run them with the exons.bed.
Yes.
Is that supposed to be in the practical folder?
So it's just a different kind of information that we're going to.
It's in the BedTools demo.
This is just, he just said CPG. I wouldn't have known this.
Okay.
change
just because you said that, oh yeah, B is just your CPGs have already been sequenced, but that's we're just using the ones available. A is the guy that you've been working with, and it's saying that the CBG 116, which is in this file, overlaps with the first three of A, which is this region.
I see, but where, like, where is this one? Oh, the, oh, I see what you're saying. I see what you're saying.
So
this,
for
is,
each
this is the actual, this is the read,
yeah.
And this is the reference.
Yeah, that's the sequence that you have. I think this is just the name that's given to that CBG on chromosome 1 in the second folder, whatever B. That's what I think is happening.
Okay. Okay.
But are you printing both of them? X head minus one. Yeah, I think that's it. I think. Check that out.
It's like I'm just going down the list.
This BAM file in. Except it hits .bam in the BetTools demo folder has been created for you to run this portion of your tutorial, which is where you take a BAM file and you calculate the you know, using SAM tools, you index it, you create a chromosome 20 SAM file, and you calculate from that, you just create a BAM file for the chromosome 20. So all of these are just advanced SAM tools things that I've done, just so that you know, supposing you wanted to just get the reads on chromosome 20 into a separate file, how do you do that? I mean, it could be chromosome 5, whatever you want, but this is just an example. And then finally, using this remaining reads.bam, you'd say bam to bed, convert it to reads.bam, then pipe that to coverage with the exons.bed and get the coverage. Okay, let me go over this one more time, just to make it clear. Now, you do not have to convert and do any of these steps. You can just simply put here accepted hits.bam and it'll work. Let me write that down. So, if you don't want to, you don't have to convert accepted hits.bam to reads.bam as above. You can use that directly here as follows. Okay. Is everybody with me still? All right, so there are two possibilities. You can use accepted hits or reads.bam, and either way is you can calculate the coverage for that. And
so you're doing either of those commands, right?
You could do both if you want. Just go the extra step if you wanted to. Just see, you know, one is going to be for the entire genome, the other one is just for chromosome 20. So when you see the counts, only the one, if you use the BAM file for chromosome 20, you'll only get counts for chromosome 20 genes.
So the accepted hits, that will be faster.
The accepted hits will be actually slower because it has the entire, it has the read file for the entire, all the chromosomes. Whereas the other file is got the reads for chromosome 20 only.
Oh, I see the line. Okay.
The line's above, right here.
Yeah.
We're going from reads.bam is just for chromosome, it's just for chromosome 20. Whereas the other one is for the accepted hits.bam is for the entire genome. All right, so is that clear?
Okay.
We are on board. All right, so then the remaining, is just a further downstream analysis of that. The last part is the HT-seq.
Just a quick question, Vishal. So beneath that, anywhere we see reads.bam, if we went the other way, we just substitute accepted hits up.
Exactly.
Okay.
If you decide to choose accepted hits.bam, just make sure you choose reads.bam. You could do either, right? Both should work technically. Right? Okay. Now, finally, let's quickly go over this part. Module load HT-seq and see if that works like this. Can I borrow a charger from someone? I'm going to be out of charge very soon. Thanks, perfect.
I
got it.
Okay.
see my computer shutting down and exactly. Okay, so this didn't work. I think HD is capital.
Are those above ones not okay?
Yeah, the 0.54.
Oh, yeah. Oh, wait. So we were fine, yeah. Yeah, so...
0.6.1.
Yeah, I don't see those. Yeah, I don't get those.
Okay, what do you get?
I just get HTC, that's it. I don't see any versions below that when I do the double.
Try HD capital. I don't know if there should be something with that. It doesn't show up. Huh? There's nothing in capitals, right?
Just HT and tab.
Yeah, mine throws me some.
Okay, so I think I found a couple HT.
Yeah.
If you just do the tab,
you
can find a couple.
On the capital.
On modulo tab, it'll come up with all lowercase.
On lowercase ones, right?
Lowercase ones, yeah.
So, who does everybody get at least one HTSeq version or no?
No, I just get
same.
Forward slash and that's it.
Yeah, that's the thing that I get.
You don't get any version.
It just fills out HTSeq forward slash
and forward slash and
okay, so that's the default one, right? So, if you just go modulo HTSeq.
Oh,
then
yeah, no, I do get. Okay, so actually, once you get the forward slash, that will click on the tab again.
Uh huh.
Yeah.
And then you'll get some versions.
Oh, yeah.
So, it's.
The two I've tried are not run though.
0.54, 0.61, and HTC default.
Yeah,
all mine will fail to load.
Oh,
really? Yep. PCL command execution.
So everybody's getting those errors, which means that we need to load Python module environment. So give me a second. I will have that for you in just one second.
Like, if we ran into this problem, how are we supposed to know that we're supposed to do what you just said we're supposed to do?
You're supposed to contact, you know what you're supposed to do? You're supposed to, yeah, you're supposed to come to me, and like I said, once you take this course, you have free consulting for life for small things like this, all right?
Can you just
write
Python?
Or you could also just email HPC support since you know they're the ones that are actually responsible for making sure that every lab has all their tools and software and they're the ones who installed it. So you should email them, and if they don't respond back, then you could be like, hey Vishal, you know they're not.
They're the worst.
Yeah.
Oh no!
I have a horse.
We have that on video.
They're the absolute worst. It's 8 hours to like 8 hours with them on the phone trying to download freaking MATLAB.
Oh, MATLAB. That's MATLAB.
Okay, so in order to
my MIT license in an hour and 20 minutes of that was me.
Here, my fellow people, let's try this first and see if it works. We're gonna try to. So module load Python 2.7.3, and then we're going to try to load module load HTSeq 0.6.1, okay? And boom, that works, okay? So HTSeq, because it's written in Python, it requires two dependencies. I'm going to just add that to the file, and then also... So first you go module load Python slash 2.7.3, and then you go module load... HTSeq slash 0.6.1. Okay, so these two commands right here.
You need NumPy too, apparently.
Oh, you don't have NumPy?
No,
I don't know.
that's separate?
Yeah.
So try seeing if you can load NumPy separately. So module.
So if that worked, you're good?
Yeah, if it works, you're good.
Oh,
so Python 2.7.3 comes with NumPy.
What the hell is NumPy?
Yeah.
Is that? I mean, so NumPy is a numeric. It's a toolkit that Python uses to like think of it as another package or a module to load required for Python to run properly.
Okay.
If it is not run by default, that means that you need to add it. So just pick the. I mean, honestly, I don't know which one. I'd probably pick the latest one.
This one I can't load. Python
2.7.3. Python slash 2.7.3. This command.
0.2, I think, is the latest one, right?
Okay. Here we
so 0.6.1 will work with 2.7.3 Python.
Oh.
There's a slash and a dash. It doesn't matter which one.
Yeah.
Dash and slash.
These two commands. I've highlighted them for you.
Yeah.
Okay. So
yeah.
If it gives you an error for NumPy, then just basically load that for Python.
Okay.
Which number?
There we go.
Well, again, I don't know. So, if does it give you an error?
I didn't get that far.
So, if you don't get an error, don't load it.
Okay.
Only load it if it gives you an error, and if it does, then just load the /1.10.2 or numpies.
1.7.2.
1.7.2, if that works.
It says I need 1.3.
So, anyways, moving on. You can try all these things on your own, and you know, basically, if you get stuck, get in touch with me. HTC count is what we want to use to count the reads, which align to our, you know, based on the transcript. So you do HTC count, and then it gives you a tutorial. Okay. All right. HTC count -F SAM type or format if it's a SAM file. Default is SAM, so if you go -F or -- format is equal to BAM, then it'll be, you know, it'll be a BAM file. Otherwise, it expects a SAM by default. So here, let me write that down. Here, you can go htseek-count -M intersection strict, which is the module, -S no. And then -- format equal to BAM. And then you can then say the name of the BAM file, which is in our case accepted_hits.bam, followed by the path to the GTF file. In our case, that would be under /data/mghcc-bioinformatics-class/ htseek. What is the name of that folder? This would be this one, htseek practical. That folder, if you see in that htseek practical folder, you have this top hg3638.gtf. Okay? So this was a GTF that was created. So I'm gonna add that. Wait, sorry. So that one is the 427. Do not copy it. So just basically here, htseek-practical. /top hg38.gtf, right? So that's the command. Now, I know you didn't get all of it, so take a moment to write this down in your files. Yes, I will go ahead and wrap it, yeah.
Can you actually send the most update LSF file after this?
What I'll do is I will save this back into the, it's gonna be saved, in fact, it is saved right now.
Then we can
back,
it,
you
then
can
we
just
it.
Copy it again from where it was, like the CP command.
From the shell's folder.
From
not
folder.
Not from my folder. It's actually, oh yeah, it is under my folder. So you can just copy it from my folder to yours, and you will have the latest. Okay. And if you have reached here, let me. Oh yes, view text display show project.
And here.
Yeah. Okay. So we're here. -M, note there is no actual enter here. There's a space here after accepted_hits.bam. I'm gonna try and run this right now to see if it actually works.
It does.
It does?
It's running.
Linda's one step ahead of me. Okay, so I'm not gonna run, if Linda's running it, don't anybody else run.
The text right there.
Oh yes. So nobody run this, it's one person is running it, so that's enough.
Will I be in trouble because I'm still on the, on the cluster, I'm on the...
Well, technically you should be on the interactive node when you run this, but I think it'll run fast enough that it won't, and it's one sample, and the BAM file is a few MB, it's 2.2 MB.
Okay.
So it's not going to be that bad. All right?
How does one get off of the interactive node onto the cluster?
Yeah, so you do this command. So you have this, I have this bsub minus q interact minus is bin bash. So this was the command to open an interactive node. So if you use this command, you can just open an interactive node and then run the previous command, which was this one, the htc count. Again, if you want to take it down, this is the command. bsub minus q interact minus is slash bin slash bash.
And once you do this, it kind of figure out where to send your things amongst all different
nodes. It'll just
nodes
assign you a random node. Do not do the minus n4, minus n8. That's just for me. It's for, you know, if I need more nodes than one. This is for parallel getting four nodes. You only need one.
So we can do this anytime. There's no penalty or any
no.
reservation
no.
or any sort of issue.
No.
Okay.
All right. So htseq will run, and then you will have your counts. And the rest of the tutorial is self-explanatory here. So, and then, you know, if you have any issues with this tutorial, let me know. I think it should be fine. It's basically just going over bet tools in general. So again, so this Thursday, we're not having the tutorial session. If you need time one-on-one, we can arrange that just via email. Okay? Okay. And with that, the tutorial is over.